Hi and welcome. We've got a bit of a long day today. However, in terms of the timetable, just one quick note that I just wanted to say. We've extended the lunch, so it's 1:45 to 2:30, because I think we're going to need that break. So, yeah, because it is a very, very long day. So, I just want to go very quickly through thanks and then introduce the speakers and maybe say one or two things before our first speaker starts. So, really to thank is the ICF, the International Curators Forum, University UEA, University of the Arts, London, Arts Council of England, and most importantly, the Hutchins Centre for African and African American Research, Harvard, and as I pointed out yesterday, His Royal Highness Henry Louis Gates, normally known as Skip. you'll laugh at that as well, yeah. So, I'm going to go very briefly into the introductions in the order that we're going to do them. I hope people have the program in front of me. We're going to kick off with Allison Thompson, who's in front of me. So I get to introduce you today, Allison. So Allison Thompson is currently the director in the Division of Fine Arts Centre for the Visual and Performing Arts at the Barbados Community College and co-directs Punch, Creative Arena, an initiative for creative action along with Ewan Atkinson. She is co-author of the book Art in Barbados, What Kind of Mirror Image, and recently co-edited Curated in the Caribbean, which is a great book, by the way. Our second speaker is Captain Morgan Quaintance. And I have to say Captain Morgan because, Captain Morgan's spice, yes. I'm keeping it very sweet for you, Morgan. He's a writer, musician, and broadcaster. He's also the 2015-60 Curator of Folk at Cubic Gallery, London. Our third speaker, let me see if I can get this right, Evan Ifekoya. Did I get that right? The second one? Oh, okay. Maybe third time lucky. Is an interdisciplinary artist exploring the politicization of culture and aesthetics. Appropriated material from historical archives and contemporary society make up the work. By querying popular imagery and utilizing the props of everyday life, the aim is to destroy the aura of preciousness surrounding art. Recent exhibitions include All of Us Have a Sense of Rhythm at David Roberts Art Foundation, Embodied Spaces, Studio Voltaire, and 30 Years of the Future at the Castlefield Gallery, Manchester. Recent performances have taken place at the David Roberts Art Foundation and Tate Modern, as well as the Marlborough in Brighton. And how did you know how to pronounce this one? To the... In Amsterdam? How do you pronounce that one? Ah, okay. Go for it. I've not actually been to that space. Last but not least, in our last line of speakers, is Lyle Ashton Harris. Apart from being one of the original members of the Ocean's 11 team of the Mirage in 1995. For more than two decades, Lyle Ashton Harris has cultivated a diverse artistic practice ranging from photographic media, collage, installation, and performance. His work explores intersections between the personal and the political, examining the impact of ethnicity, gender, and desire on the contemporary social and cultural dynamic. Known for his self-portraits and use of pop culture icons such as Billie Holiday, Michael Jackson, Harris teases the viewers' perceptions and expectations, re-signifying cultural curators and recalibrating the familiar with the extraordinary. His work has been exhibited internationally, including the Whitney Museum of Art, the Guggenheim Museum, the 52nd Venice Biennale, and his work has been acquired by major institutions and museums, most recently by the Museum of Modern Art in New York. His commissioned work has been featured in a wide range of publications, including New York Times Magazine and The New Yorker. One I forgot to mention yesterday, which I'll very briefly mention today, is that the thing that fascinates me about Fanon and Fanon's legacy is the question around ambivalence and the question around agency and the question around subjectivity. And what's really interesting about Fanon's work is how he doesn't really name it, but he somehow, through his work around psychiatry and his work around post-colonialism, talks about the idea of ideological formations. Somehow these institutions have these kind of very particular and specific ideological formations, and yet within these ideological formations, we kind of kind of inhibit them, but in the process, which is where Fanon becomes much more interesting, in the process of inhibiting them, we get this kind of ambivalence. In some ways, we're attracted to them, but somehow we don't like them, but somehow we desire them at the same time. So really, that's my way of really talking about how somehow I want to kind of use that framework to think about how somehow, in terms of the contemporary art world, there is those kind of ideological formations, there's those processes which are kind of post-Fanonian, which at the same time attract us somehow. We're desired towards them, but somehow we strategically have alliances to kind of repel against them and create something new, which I'm hoping with some of the stuff that we'll be talking about today. Our first panel is called Platforms and Desires for Institutional Frameworks, and in this one, the speakers will discuss the possible role of institutions both in upholding structural violence and decolonizing culture, how platforms and institutions have changed since the 1995, which changes are necessary for the future, and how we might avoid the traps of monoculture and exoticism in representation. Thank you for being here, and Allison, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Okay, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Are you hearing me? Yes? All right. I'd like to begin by congratulating David and all of his colleagues on this 20th anniversary of the Mirage exhibition, and to thank him for inviting me to be part of this commemoration. Mirage, Enigmas of Race, Difference, and Desire. Was organized as a moment to consider the importance of Frantz Fanon and the ways in which his writings, particularly Black Skin, White Masks, intertwined with artistic practices in the mid-1990s. 2 decades on, this reflexive look at this event, the works produced, as well as the events and publications that surrounded it, as a response to Fanon's ideas, ask us to consider the contemporary moment. What is the legacy of this event, and what work remains to be done? Now, this panel focuses on platforms and institutional frameworks, and I want to focus on a series of events that happened in those intervening years that have addressed and built on many of those same ideas that were addressed in Mirage, and which have focused on building platforms and institutional frameworks that could bring greater visibility and agency to art and artists in the Caribbean. So this is a Black Diaspora Visual Arts program, which was initiated by the curator of the Mirage exhibition, David, along with myself and another colleague who's sitting in the second row, Alessandra Cummins, which began in 2007. It links to and in many ways can be seen as a child of the Mirage experience. The Black Diaspora Visual Arts, or BDVA for short, began in 2007 in Barbados as part of a series of events marking the bicentenary of the abolition of the British transatlantic slave trade. It emerged out of a partnership between 2 young entities, the Barbados National Art Gallery Committee and the International Curators Forum. Now, unlike Jamaica, unlike the Bahamas, Bermuda, Guyana, Cayman Islands, Barbados does not have a national gallery. More specifically, it lacks a functioning institutional framework devoted to the development of the visual arts in terms of providing and facilitating adequate local, regional, and international platforms for visual arts and visual artists. The NAGC was established in 1999 by the then Minister of Culture to make recommendations for the establishment of a national gallery. The NAGC, as it's called, set in place an acquisitions program and an educational program which resulted in a number of exhibitions, workshops, symposiums, and publications. But there's no permanent home and there's no permanent staff. The committee members were personally invested in building this kind of infrastructure and pursued an active program of developing working collaborations regionally and internationally with particular focus on the diaspora. And it's in this context that we reached out to David. Now, as David, when David was speaking last night, and he said, why the ICA, why Fanon, why David? Well, in addition to his impressive list of curatorial projects and publications and his family ties to Barbados, we had one important thing in common, Sonia Boyce. In 1999, Alessandra and I had co-authored, Art in Barbados, What Kind of Mirror Image? And this was the first survey of art on the island dating from the mid-20th century. Now, Vera LaPoupe, who is currently the director of the National Gallery in Jamaica, had recently published her book, Caribbean Art, as part of the World Series of Art published by Thames and Hudson. And we'd asked her to review our book. And she generally praised the book, but she did point out that it was too narrow in its focus and did not adequately take recognition of the diaspora as she had done in her final chapter of Caribbean Art. And she specifically mentioned Sonia Boyce. And so I took this comment to heart and reached out to Sonia and began a series of collaborations beginning in 2005 when Sonia came to Barbados did a workshop at the Barbados Community College. It was such a success that it led to additional workshops with artists in the community and eventually commissioning work in collaboration with Sonia that resulted in a 20-minute two-screen video entitled Crop Over, which looks at our annual festival / carnival. When we approached David and said we'd like to explore the possibility of curatorial collaboration, David said, great, and suggested we make it a 10-year collaboration. This was much more ambitious than we had envisioned, but it foregrounded two aspects that are key to David's working method and philosophy. One is a built-in commitment to continuity and sustainability, and the other is collegiality. This was not to be a one-off project, but one that could build an infrastructure and network of expanded working relationships. Fact was that there was expertise out there amongst a body of professionals who often had connections to the Caribbean and could be convinced to contribute that expertise to developing the infrastructure within the region and creating a platform for Caribbean art internationally. The initial conversation happened at the same time that the ICF, the International Curators Forum, was being launched at its first major event, a symposium in 2007 in Venice. It was at that point we began planning for our first major event, which took place in February of 2009 in Barbados. It had three main components: to invite artists locally to produce site-specific works in public spaces in Barbados, to invite artists from the wider diaspora to work alongside these artists, and to host a major visual arts conference. And it was decided that the starting point of the conference would be Stuart Hall, and specifically an essay entitled Modernity and Its Others, Three Moments in the Post-War History of Black Diaspora Arts, in which he basically describes the genealogy of diasporic artists in Britain and three generational shifts or moments in this post-war history of the black diaspora arts. So the aim was to attempt to map Hall's proposed trajectory onto the Caribbean, and specifically a Barbadian context, with particular focus on the contemporary experience. So the two-day symposium opened with a feature address by Stuart Hall. Unfortunately, Stuart wasn't able to come, but we filmed a discussion with David where they discussed the article and more fully explored the third moment in his trajectory, which is the contemporary moment. And in that video, in that discussion, Hall expanded on the essay to consider a parallel or possible successive moments within the Caribbean, which simultaneously acknowledges and critiques its precedents. After that discussion, renowned Barbadian author George Lamming was present at the symposium, and he responded to Hall's presentation and actually proposed his own kind of diasporic trajectory. And this dialogue really proved to be a fertile terrain for further discussion. We had a number of presentations by local experts, Alessandra Cummins from Barbados. This is Krista Thompson, originally from the Bahamas, who's based at Northwestern. Vera LaPoupe, who's the director of the National Gallery in Jamaica. Dominique Brebion from Martinique. Christopher Cozier from Trinidad. And then also a number of international experts who we've been able to sort of maintain long-term working relationships with, such as Paul DeMella from Liverpool, Richard Powell from Duke University, and Lowry Sims, who at that point had left the Studio Museum and was then at MAD. And Lowry has kind of been a long-term godmother for us in terms of working towards the establishment of a national gallery. So there were 8 commissioned public art projects, 5 by artists based in Barbados, so I'll just show them to you quickly. The first one was Indrani Gall, and she had actually turned to the writings of Frantz Fanon and had these posters which were placed in public spaces. We were responding to the fact that there was not a national gallery. There weren't really kind of gallery spaces that could facilitate these works. Was part of the impetus for getting these works out into the public. But of course, also it was ideal because it just created much more visibility for the project itself. So this was actually based at the Central Post Office in Barbados. And in addition to these banners, Indrani had this kind of template of a crowd, an unidentified crowd. Indrani is originally from India. Married a Barbadian and moved to Barbados, and she was interested in that, the sort of the synergies between the East Indies and the West Indies, and particularly this hierarchy of at what she identifies as caste, caste and color. Members from the public then could come forward and they could, in a sense, draw their own identities onto this template. And it would be erased each day and then it would start again. And that's Indrani. The second project was by a young artist, Sheena Rose. Sheena had literally just graduated from the college a couple of months before, and she was commissioned to produce a video called Town, which looks at the busy urban environment of Bridgetown as a metaphor for this kind of mental congestion of temporary life. And it was shown in 2 venues, including in the front window of a pharmacy on Broad Street, which is the main street running through Bridgetown. And for this young graduate, just leaving school and kind of wondering what were the opportunities that were available for her in terms of, you know, deciding to pursue this career as a contemporary artist, I think this event was really pivotal, both in terms of, you know, sort of creating a viable working space for Sheena, but also in terms of setting up connections. So, for example, Christopher Cozier, who was there, runs Alice Yard in Trinidad, and that was the first residency that she went on, and then led to sort of successive events, and she's been extremely active since then. The third artist was Ewan Atkinson and Ingrid Prasad, who collaborated on a project called Starman. Starman is the artist's alter ego, and he created these projections and would go through town and project them onto various sites in Bridgetown, and then created this kind of documentary center where he tracked Starman's activities. And people could actually try the costume on, they could become Starman. This is Caroline Holder. Caroline Holder created a piece called Homeland Insecurities. It was a ceramic dinner set and was based on the fact that Caroline was based in the US but had gone to Nova Scotia to pursue an MFA between the years of 2001 and 2003. And she says, the first day of class was September 11th, 2001. When I returned to New York, I was in a prime position as an outsider to observe the enormous psychological toll taken by the event. Our world had become less safe and we less certain of a place in it. Fear lay like a thin dust over the city. No one I knew had gone untouched, but I found it particularly poignant to see images of burning towers recurring in the drawings of my young students 2 years after it occurred. Those scenes of personal insecurity, along with the ubiquitous advertising campaign, if you see something, say something, and an enlarged police presence compelled me to develop this installation. And so there are scenes of people spying on each other, wiretapping, inscriptions like, your mother's a terrorist, turn the bitch in. All right, the next installation was by Jocelyn Gardner. It was a video installation called Words Just Words, and this is projected onto the facade of the public library in Barbados, which had at that point recently been closed and has remained closed. And so there's actually a screen on the front of the door to create the illusion as if you're actually looking into this abandoned empty building. And the video showed water being thrown onto the facade of this open doorway. And so it was, and then with text running down the front. and the text was taken from Richard Ligon's 1657 book entitled A True and Exact History of the Island of Barbados, as well as text from a contemporary dub poet. And so it was this idea of this kind of clash of the historical and the post-colonial, and this idea of kind of purging the written word. And that's the artist in the center. And then to kind of integrate it with the symposium that was taking place in the conference center nearby, she had this text that was laid over the floor, on the walls, in the bathrooms, various places throughout. We also had three installations which were placed in the Parliament buildings in the middle of Bridgetown. And this first one is entitled Trace. It was Gary Stewart and Trevor Matheson. And it was a three-screen installation inside the upper floor of directly onto the coral stone buildings. And it was basically kind of a selection of images and sounds that they had captured throughout Bridgetown in the weeks leading up to the opening of the exhibition. These are scenes of it. This is the audience watching. I think this is when the artists were speaking. In the room next door, we had Ingrid Pollard, who did a piece called Belonging in Britain, which examined her role as a custodian of her parents' memories in the form of letters and photographs, recording their migration from Guyana to Britain in the 1950s. And then in the entrance, we had a project commissioned from Arthur Edwards and Francis Ross called Beyond a Boundary, which presented pairs of portrait busts of heroes of West Indian cricket contemplating themselves. At the same time, local galleries were invited to be involved through a curated exhibition called The Road to Many Towards a Genealogy of Barbadian Art, which was curated by Therese Hatchety and presented the work of 28 artists covering the three generations, which paralleled Stuart Hall's essay. So in total, there were 38 artists who were represented in the event, 35 of them from Barbados. There were also two artist talks at the time, one by Kara Walker and one by Alfredo Yar, both of whose works spoke powerfully to the issues under deliberation. And the result of the symposium, in tandem with the exhibitions, was a recurring shift between the local and the global, the national and the diasporic. There are a number of kind of interesting, sort of unexpected outcomes that come from this as well, including the fact that Alfredo Yar is Chilean, but actually grew up in Martinique. And coming to this event was the first time that he had actually returned to the Caribbean. One of the speakers, Dominique Brebillon, was from Martinique, and they made this connection. And then subsequently, we almost had like a homecoming where we went with Alfredo back to Martinique and did this kind of, you know, retracing this life of Aimé Césaire, going to his grave. Alfredo had actually gone to the Lycée Schulcher, which is where Césaire had taught, and there's this kind of shrine to Césaire at the school. He went on, I think the first night we were there, he went on the radio to kind of tell this story. He was, you know, he'd left as a young teenager, and he was off the radio for about half an hour, and a woman called and said, you know, I was your neighbor, we grew up beside one another, and they made those kinds of great connections. And there's been some kind of discussion of him possibly doing a monument to Césaire in Martinique. These are a number of my students from the community college who were also involved in the symposium as interns. So, right, just some press about sort of the visibility that the event had. We've shifted between sort of larger events and smaller events. This was a one-day symposium which we held in December when? 2009, thank you. Which was attached to a larger symposium for the Museums Association of the Caribbean and the International Council of Museums. And we were able to bring in a number of speakers, Akwi Enwezer, as well as some artists who had been involved with the original Mirage exhibition, including Keith Piper and John Acomfra. But the next large event that we held was actually in 2011, and this was entitled Black Jacobins, Negritude in a Post-Global 21st Century, and was organized with support from the Andy Warhol Foundation. And like Mirage, this event sought to examine major Caribbean writers of the mid-20th century and the way in which their themes addressed and resonated with contemporary visual practice. And so we focused specifically for this event on the writing of Aimé Césaire, who was responsible for the Negritude movement and particularly focused on his Cahier d'un retour au pays natal, Notebook of a Return to My Native Land, and the simultaneous publication of Black Jacobins by the Trinidadian author C.L.R. James. The central core of the project was to explore, as I say, the legacy of these ideas in the works by contemporary artists. And since we had an English one, a writer from the English-speaking Caribbean and a writer from the French-speaking Caribbean, we became a bit more ambitious with the structure, the actual format of the symposium. And the first half was held in Barbados, and then we all got on a plane, and the second half was held in Martinique. And it sounds exciting, and it was exciting, but there really are challenges working within the region across different language groups. And movement within the region is actually much more challenging than it should be. So to be able to kind of move people from one space to another and kind of create those synergies between the spaces, I think was quite important. We focused a lot on the moving image, and we started in Barbados by showing Stuart Hall in conversation with C.L.R. James. This was a landmark documentary and the only filmed interview with C.L.R. James. The film was produced by the British filmmaker Mike Dibb, and here is Mike presenting the film to us in Barbados. This was kind of an intervention by a Martinican artist, again, very much influenced, Christian Bertin, very much influenced by Aimé Césaire, knew Aimé Césaire when he was a young man, and he takes this drum, literally like this, on planes. I should have photographs of him trying to check this in when we were going from Barbados back to Martinique with the drum. But he's taken it through Paris, and he just kind of walks through the streets handing out the writings of Aimé Césaire. Here's the gang. And then in Martinique, the focus was, first of all, a presentation by Richard Powell, and he had written a comprehensive kind of overview looking at this theme of Black Jacobins and the writings of Césaire and C.L.R. James, and specifically kind of mapping that onto contemporary practice in the region. But we were increasingly looking at curatorial practice, and we had commissioned 9 curators throughout the region, from the Bahamas, from Haiti, from Cuba, from Puerto Rico, from Barbados, from Martinique, to write essays about their experiences about curating contemporary art in their countries. And we were able to bring everybody together in Martinique and present the work as it was developing, and to have dialogue and kind of sharing the experiences before they submitted their final papers. This is Krista Thompson from the Bahamas, and Claire Tancon, originally from Guadeloupe, now based in New Orleans. And the result was Curating in the Caribbean, which was published with support from the Prince Claus Fund. This is the end of the conference. This is Mike Dibb and Gary Stewart in Césaire's office. And then the last part of that project was, again, in this effort to try to create a platform for Caribbean art within international venues. This was the Caribbean Pavilion, which was part of the Liverpool Biennial in 2012. And basically, it was organized as part of the City States project, sited at the Contemporary Urban Center in Liverpool. City States comprised 6 self-funded international exhibitions that focused on the cultural dynamics of life in cities around the world. And it presented the work of 74 artists in total from 23 different countries, and was comparable in size to the approximately 60 artists that made up the core of the biennial itself. And so this was, and again, you know, the challenge and the expense of getting the work from the Caribbean to these venues was, in a sense, countered by organizing residencies for the artists to go to Liverpool, and they spent 2 to 3 weeks there, and many of them actually made the work in situ and responded to the space of Liverpool. And Liverpool being itself as a port, having a lot of connections with the Caribbean, having, you know, a major museum next to the Tate devoted to slavery, I think served as a point for a lot of the artists involved to respond to. So this was Christian Bertin from Martinique. This was John Beadle from the Bahamas. This is Blue Curry, also from the Bahamas. I got that in there again. This is David Damoisson from Martinique, Ewan Atkinson from Barbados. This is part of the installation. He had created this book, which is this kind of response to somebody traveling from Barbados to Liverpool, and then set up school desks and a wall where people could respond to the exercises that are set out in this sort of primary reader. This is Heino Smit, a video, and LeVar Munro from the Bahamas. I'm wrapping up right now. right. And here are some of the artists with one of the assistant curators for the event. So, right, in conclusion, it's at this point that I'm supposed to present you with a conclusion, and I don't really have one. In the lead up to 2017, which is supposed to be the culmination of the Black Diaspora Visual Arts, we're entering a period of sort of floundering and uncertainty, which is unfortunate because it's coinciding with a particular moment, a particularly charged moment and opportunity. In addition to the considerable accomplishments of the past, next year marks the 50th anniversary of independence for Barbados. And in 2017, the regional arts festival, Carafesta, will be hosted in Barbados for the second time, the first being in 1981, so with a 35-year gap. But with the ending of the National Art Gallery Committee and the establishment of a board, there was literally no handover. And with dwindling budgets both in Barbados and the UK, all of these factors have severely limited the capacity to develop new projects, which should mark a certain culmination of the trajectory that we had initially planned in 2007. If this cycle of activity, followed by lull, is the norm rather than the exception, then it is those spaces without already entrenched institutions and infrastructure that risk losing the progresses that they've been able to accumulate. Moments like this symposium provide opportunities then, where we can engage in critical dialogue about the legacies of these events, such as Mirage, that share a commitment to bringing greater visibility to artists, curators, and writers, and issues that have been marginalized, where we can identify where breakthroughs did indeed occur, but also acknowledge those areas where really not enough has changed. Thank you.
We're going to take questions after the presentations. I'm just going to invite Morgan to the lectern.
Sorry, I wasn't going to have a slide or anything before we started this. Then I was sitting there suddenly thinking, oh, I can show this. all right, cool. Can I like make that big? I suppose it's big enough. Yeah. All right, so before I begin, I just wanted to say thanks to David for inviting me to be here and give this talk. Thanks to the ICA for letting me be here, and thanks to you for coming, because I don't know why I always have this fear that I'll turn up, there'll be nobody in the audience, especially because it's Saturday and the sun's out. So thank you. It's a real privilege to be able to get up and talk about things that you've been thinking about for a while, so thank you for allowing me to do this. So let's move swiftly on. So before I run through my 15 minutes, I want to press, hang on, let me see. Yeah, so before I run through my 15 minutes, I want to proceed things with the admission that I currently have very little belief in the power of already existing mid to top level art institutions to affect significant sociocultural change. That's not to say I don't believe art institutions perform a crucial social function. They do. Providing publics with the space to grapple with cultural and political complexity is, I think, essential, especially when those spaces, from humanities courses to public libraries, are vanishing elsewhere in the UK. But although the presentation of contemporary art allows institutions to stage or perform cultural complexity and left-leaning political engagement, this radicalism doesn't extend to how said institutions actually operate. Consequently, we're in the midst of strange institutional times, where galleries are radical in theory but neoliberal in practice. For example, today, the presentation of art by somebody considered to be an anti-authoritarian dissident is being facilitated by staff on 0 hours contracts who are paid below the living wage of £9.15 an hour to issue tickets and check the coats of patrons who have paid £17.50 to enter or £11 if they're unemployed. I'm of course talking about Ai Weiwei at the Royal Academy here, but there are many institutions across London and the UK dancing to the same rhythm, but humming a slightly different melodic variation on this neoliberal tune. The point is, in this current climate, innovation isn't going to come from an established field who have already accepted questionable practices in order to fulfill their monetary bottom lines. It will have to come from elsewhere. So with that said, what I'm going to do here now is briefly address two things. First, how platforms and institutions have changed since 1995. And second, how we might avoid the traps of monoculture and exoticism in representation. So first, if we take 1995 as our starting point, we can say arts institutions, that is mid to top level galleries and museums, have ostensibly become more international, expansive, and concerned with audience participation and community engagement. What's not so clear is why. Perhaps it was because of the groundswell of political attention paid to the field of contemporary art in the 1980s and 90s. Perhaps post-colonial theory, feminism, queer theory, institutional critique, relational aesthetics, transhumanism, hacktivism, and postmodernism dismantled the old ways of doing things and institutions had no choice but to follow. Or maybe certain top-tier institutions began to change and others, fearing illegitimacy, irrelevance, or the loss of Arts Council funding, just followed suit. Whatever the case, the initial spark of radicalism has cooled off. Yes, institutions are more international in that they pay cursory attention to spaces outside of Europe and North America, but it's also unfortunate that these spaces are often filtered through European and North American perspectives, value systems, philosophies, symbolic orders, and representational hierarchies. But so what? Who really looks to establish galleries anymore, especially when we have so many new independent spaces, grassroots collectives, and alternative publishing initiatives? And what about the internet? Aren't people now finally free to express who they really are in the many permutations of self that are currently being performed and actualized online? Isn't the World Wide Web the most relevant space to offer new representations and challenge old essentialist notions? Which brings me to the second topic. How might we avoid the traps of monoculture and exoticism in representation? Let's start with monoculture. For me, the key is a fairly obvious truism. To avoid the traps of monoculture and exoticism in representation, you have to embrace heterogeneity. It seems to me that monoculture arrives out of homogeneous social and culture groups in which group members have extremely similar values, lifestyles, and belief systems. In such environments, idiosyncrasies, individual moral frameworks, and the particularities of character can become reduced and supplanted by an overarching group consciousness that is more often than not far less nuanced than the individual view. Previously, the overarching goal of civil rights meant marginalized subject positions worked together in rough alliance. But today, it can sometimes seem like the successes of the civil rights movement and identity politics have led to a kind of pervasive factionalism. So as marginal subject positions arise out of strongly cohesive groups with strict membership criteria that excludes others, monoculture arises. Now, in the 1979 interview, critic and curator Lucy Lippard described her approach to working in the art world as being informed by a trialectic. She wrote, "I've been mumbling for years about a trialectic for women artists. Their work existing and actually working not only in the art world, that's one, but in the real world, that's two, and in the feminist world, that's three." The feminist world she qualifies as the separatist world, if you like. So it seems to me that trialectic functioning is helpful in relation to identity politics as well. While it's important to identify and maintain the marginal subject position, it's also important to think beyond that to the fundamental communality of human race, and then to think beyond that still to the plane of consciousness. So for example, of myself, I could say, well, I'm black, I'm a human being, I'm a conscious thinking thing. For me, the last of these three positions, that I'm a conscious thinking thing, is the one that feels least like an extraneous cultural construct with a set of reductive essentialisms that are designed to oppress some and advance others. It also feels like the ultimate end goal of civil rights. If anti-racism is ultimately about uncovering the fiction of race, feminism is about uncovering the fiction of gender, and queer theory is about uncovering the fiction of normative sexuality. So Lippard's trialectic approach is useful here because the subject species consciousness model can help to keep the dissolution of race, gender, and sexuality in one's mind as a possible end goal. This is a goal that, of course, may not be achievable in our lifetimes, because there is one, still so much work to be done with regards to race, gender, sexuality, and humanity, still so many histories to uncover, still so much damage and systemic violence to heal, and still so much injustice and abuse to fight. But I think working on all three fronts, so the subject, the species, and the consciousness, will allow for a critical overview of one's position, which leads to two things: the avoidance of monocultural traps and a way to move beyond prescribed areas of correct interest specific to your subject position. So in the words of the artist Jimmy Durham, once said to me, I have to be both a Native American artist and not a Native American artist. So due to lack of time, I'm just going to finish things with like seven notes on monoculture, difference, and heterogeneity that have been generating interesting thoughts for me over this past year. Hopefully they might prove as interesting starting points for conversations later on today. And I'll finish up with a really brief survey of this project that I'm involved in. So one, in an otherwise abusive and unpleasant conversation between Julie Birchall and Paris Lees on intersectionality, Birchall clarifies her hostility to intersectionality maintained in a multicultural field. She states, "I don't think the social classes in British universities mix in the way they used to. It used to be easy to take on other struggles because you met lots of different people. Even though people do go on about diversity a lot, they do stay in very tight groups socially, and very few of them mix with a wide variety of people." Point two, on a research trip to Cape Town, I'm struck by how racially heterogeneous parts of the city's population is. I learned about an area called District 6 that, along with Sophiatown in Johannesburg, was effortlessly multicultural until the apartheid government's programme of forced removals pushed peoples into townships in the Cape Flats. The District 6 Museum in Cape Town commemorates both the area and the traumatic events of forced removal, and it was inspiring for me to see a mixed race experience, not just black and white, but black and Asian, Indonesian and Jewish, Jewish and North African, and whatever other configurations you might be able to think of, held up as an exemplary sociocultural model. Thanks, Astrid. Sweet. I'll touch it a little bit, so yeah, I won't go to sleep. So held up as an exemplary sociocultural model, whilst discrete multiculturalism What I mean by discrete is like, well, it's sort of, it's pretty obvious, but while discrete multiculturalism is celebrated in the West, the mixed race position has yet to be articulated in as considered a way as I experienced in Cape Town. Three, in the first few pages of her book, The People, The Rise and Fall of the Working Class, author Selina Todd writes, "Throughout this book, we shall see there was never a homogeneous white working class whose interests and identity can be distinguished from that of Black Britons or recent migrants." Point four. So on a recent trip to Japan, I discovered that the current Miss Japan is a mixed race woman of African American and Japanese descent called Ariana Miyamoto. Point number five. It also occurred to me that while Japan is famously homogeneous nation, it has embraced the kind of cultural heterogeneity, these words are so hard to say all the time, but to say, using another word just means a long-winded explanation. So it has embraced a kind of cultural heterogeneity, in big cities at least, via a kind of benign appropriation. Number six, here's Richard Sennett on Claude Lévi-Strauss. The anthropologist called bricolage the process of disassembling culture into pieces and then packing it for travel. Lévi-Strauss called metics those who practiced bricolage, transforming an ancient Greek usage for outsiders into the idea of people who can remember where they came from, even while accepting they can no longer live there. This kind of travel he called metissage, a journey in which there is change but not forgetting, the traveller thereby retaining a certain measure of security and self-confidence in facing and accepting the incoherence of the outside and the new. So I'll just talk for a few minutes quickly about a project that I'm involved in called DAM Projects. So sensing this institutional homogeneity and a reluctance to change or embrace things that I thought were pertinent to contemporary life, I and two other curators formed this curatorial collective called DAM Projects. One of the things we believed in was looking at the sort of international experience from a kind of embedded subcultural perspective. And what we felt we meant by that was that usually sometimes the practice of going into international spaces by curatorial interest is that you arrive in town, you survey a few people about who is the most significant person in this place, and then you bring that person back over to the UK in order to illustrate what is happening in this other city or nation that you've been to. But we thought, well, what's most interesting to us, because obviously being in London and seeing the same happen from this city, whereby people pick sort of top tier artists and then sort of try and illustrate the climate with those artists, we thought it'd be more interesting to go and look at what's happening from a subcultural perspective and to allow sort of emerging artists and emerging sociocultural and political debates to come through. So basically what we did is within DAM Projects, we staged a project, a year long project, where we traveled to six cities across the world. And what we did was we shot a documentary about the city and also met lots of artists and brought those artists back to stage one day exhibitions. Now we had to do that because we didn't have an institution that would allow us to stage something for longer. We only had a place that could allow us to do something for a day. But we were also building up to a larger exhibition that will happen next year. That's 2 months that will bring all the six cities together and all the artists we've met. But one of the interesting things about doing this is that we were able to really sort of get into those communities and see how things are working, start some conversations, and then also start some sort of exchanges between those different cities and institutions. So across the year, we visited New Orleans was the first place we went to. Then we went to Derry in Northern Ireland. Then we went to Malmo in Sweden. Then we went to Cape Town in South Africa, Detroit in America. And Tokyo is the final one. And at each time, one of the three of the collective sort of spearheaded what was going to be happening there. But what was sort of exciting and interesting to us is that quite quickly politics came to the forefront. We quickly noticed that some of the traditional sort of arts conversations you might have about emerging scenes were the same. You're always talking to people, well, we need more coverage, we need more institutions, we need more critics, then we need the cities to pay attention to us. And so those debates were becoming quite homogeneous. We're just having the same conversation in every city. But politically and socially, things were really, really different. So, for instance, the existence of transgender performance artists in New Orleans is really, really different to the existence of transgender performance artists in Cape Town. And we were really excited about possibly connecting these two people and, allowing some sort of, international exchange that was not really predicated on already existing structures or already existing debates. It wasn't about whether or not it was pertinent to the art world, it was just about whether or not it interested us and it felt pertinent socially or culturally. So I can't really go into too much about these projects here because we don't really have the time. But please, please have a look. Go to our website, damnprojects.com, and you can find all the stuff we've done about these places on there. And also you can watch documentaries that we've shot, broadcast quality documentaries, mind, that we shot on a budget. that really have not much of us in them and have mostly the people and the places that we visited in them. But also I would say one of the things that's really interesting about this project is how a lot of these cities are networked anyway. We didn't realize that the District Sick Museum in Cape Town exists in this sort of museum network with Malmo and Derry because they have institutions that have been founded to commemorate traumatic events. So I'm running out of time, but broadly what I wanted to say was how have institutions changed since 1995? Well, a lot have changed, a lot has stayed the same. On the surface of things, they're more international, but actually they're more neoliberal in practice because people are paid less now than they were when I was working in a bookshop in the Hale Gallery, for example. So what do we do with that? Well, I think we have to look to alternative models. We have to try to change things ourselves, possibly, and that if those things become suitably popular, then laggardly institutions will follow, because that's what they do. The second thing is about monoculture, and I would just say the way we avoid monoculture is to embrace heterogeneity. Don't be afraid of it. It's the lifeblood of cities, and I think it is, if we do have a zeitgeist, or if contemporaneity can be defined, that is what it is. All right, so thanks very much.
Thank you. Thanks, Morgan. As I said before, we'll take up some of that as well as Alison's in terms of our discussion. Evian, the floor is yours.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Thank you, David, for the invitation. Originally I was going to present an updated text of something I performed or not performed at INIVA in November of 2014. A text that I presented in place of the performance I was going to do. INIVA's funding had just been majorly cut, and the future of the organization was uncertain. So I'll briefly describe what the text consisted of. So I wasn't in the space of the performance. As you can see, this image is how the space looked. There was a mirror in the middle of the room, which is not unimportant. So a recording plays where I describe the performance I was going to do. And actually looking back over the text, it seems quite prescribed, but in the moment of the performance, it's unrehearsed. So I go on to talk about my frustration with the kinds of interactions I was having with institutions at the time. And it wasn't just INIVA. And then I end with a proposal for a more productive way of working, where emerging practices can be nurtured and supported rather than just facilitated or directed. The text is available online on my blog if it's something you wanna read. But then I changed my mind and I wanna address the work of Fanon a bit more directly and consider kind of the institution of his work and how his work has been institutionalized, especially in relation to black art practice, whatever that means. So what can or should burgeoning practices take from his work today? So I began to reread some of his texts and I looked back over the Mirage catalog. And in doing so, I was reminded of Fanon's homophobia and misogyny, which, despite his importance in the development of post-colonial thought, I can't really ignore. And in the Mirage exhibition catalogue, Kabina Mercer does some work to destabilise the notion of Fanon as a hero and suggests we don't read his texts as repositories of truth. So I'm a bit obsessed with Fred Moten at the moment. He's a poet, intellectual, and professor based in America. And I've re-listened to his recent talk on blackness and non-performance about five times since he delivered it at the end of September. I listened to it again soon after I received the invitation to present at this event, and I caught something I hadn't on my first listen. So on Emmanuel Levinas, he says, an anti-blackness whose structural force is shared by Hannah Arendt and even Frantz Fanon manifests as a residual of phenomenology's self-concern and its focus on discrete singularity as both subject and object. Yeah, so it's a remark that Moten doesn't really elaborate on any further, but to be honest, it was something that I couldn't really let go of. And, you know, I'm not an academic, I'm an artist, so my way of engaging with this was as an artist, so I'm just going to foreground that. But yeah, I just couldn't let go of what he was saying. And Moten has discussed the work of Fanon before in several of his earlier texts, including The Case of Blackness from 2008, and then Blackness and Nothingness, Mysticism in the Flesh from 2013. So I decided to think through what exactly he might be getting at a little bit more. So I hope you don't mind, but the rest of this talk is me thinking through Fanon, the institution of Fanon, in relation to the work of Fred Moten. So next image. All right, and so some new but not completely formed thoughts. So in October 1998, Toni Morrison wrote an article about Bill Clinton for The New Yorker. I'm going to read a key paragraph. African-American men seemed to understand it right away. Years ago, in the middle of the Whitewater investigation, one heard the first rumors. White skin notwithstanding, this is our first black president. Blacker than any actual black person who could ever be elected in our children's lifetime. After all, Clinton displays almost every trope of blackness. Single-parent household, born poor, working class, saxophone playing, McDonald's and junk food loving boy from Arkansas. And when virtually all the African American Clinton appointees began one by one to disappear, when the president's body, his privacy, his unpoliced sexuality became the focus of the persecution, when he was metaphorically seized and body searched, who could gainsay these black men who knew whereof they spoke? The message was clear. No matter how smart you are, how hard you work, how much coin you earn for us, we will put you in your place or put you out of the place you have somehow, albeit with our permission, achieved. You will be fired from your job, sent away in disgrace, and, who knows, maybe sentenced and jailed to boot. In short, unless you do as we say, i.e. assimilate at once, your expletives belong to us. Then, so fast forward to 2015, and we have Rachel Dolezal. I hope we are all familiar with this case, because actually I don't really feel like going into the details. I got into plenty of arguments on Twitter about this one, and, you know, this case of transracial, you know, I'm not really here for that, to be honest. Right, so instead, here is an image of a spoof set of emojis. So both Dolezal and Clinton, according to Morrison, seem to suggest that blackness might not actually be that which is inscribed onto the skin. So from this point on, I like to call cases such as this avatars of blackness. And then I'm just going to slight move to the side. So an excerpt from a selection of words I wrote in reflection to the recent Mirage event that was organized at LADA, the Live Art Development Agency. I think it was the beginning of this month. I just wrote down, "My desire is not visible here. Don't feel at home in this blackness, ? I have the right to not be understood, opacity after glisson. A pleasure put on the surface of things." So I often find myself failing in blackness, kind of especially when I am in spaces of blackness. It's rarely in relation to the white man that Fanon often invokes. What kind of governance did Fanon create around blackness? And might that be, and might this be what Fanon, what Moten is referring to? Is addressing the stateness of blackness always going to be in service of its preservation, even when trying to move away from its limits? So at the Artist Film Club Avant Noir screening here at the ICA earlier, I think it was in July, curated by Greg DeQuire Jr., who is speaking later today, something began to become clear in my mind. Well, actually, I wouldn't say it became clear, but it kind of appeared. I witnessed physical manifestations of blackness's lack of body whilst moving through the body, particularly in the work of Loretta Fahrenholz in her video Ditch Plains. So I'm just going to quote a Frieze article by Kirsty Bell in May 2014, which was reviewing her work. "Lit by dayglow strips, the dancers move as if possessed, but the film's compelling urgency is rather born of dispossession. The question of how to act in a disaster zone or in a life punctuated by stop and search, interrogation and vigilation, when actions themselves are out of your hands. Could it be a useful project to think of blackness as material, distinct from skin?" So in the Mirage exhibition catalogue, Stuart Hall is quoted to have described the work coming out of the period of the exhibition as marking an end of the innocent notion of the essential black subject. But what if there is no black subject, in inverted commas, at all? After all, the only way to be able to emulate something is to know what it is. So it can only be governed and in turn policed if it is defined. So why must I bear the burden of proving anything? So according to Gabina Mercer, works in the original exhibition address issues of fear and fantasy in relation to black subjectivity. And we, so I'm talking about kind of artists who are kind of, you know, emerging, burgeoning at the same kind of moment as me, are dealing with this past and its reflections, more with the realities of blackness than its fantasies, no longer merely a subject in combat with his own image, as Fanon would say. You know, I know what it is to die. I see it every day. But what does it mean to live and what makes it possible? In the paper Blackness and Nothingness, Moten draws on the work of Frank B. Wilderson. "I am nothing, Naima, and you are nothing. The unspeakable answer to your question within your question. This is why I could not, would not, answer your question that night. Would I ever be with a black woman again?" It was earnest, not accusatory, I know. And nothing terrifies me more than such a question asked in earnest. Is it a question that goes to the heart of desire, to the heart of our black capacity to desire? But what if we take out the nouns that you used, nouns of habit that get us through the day? Your question to me would sound like this: would nothing ever be with nothing again? Moten goes on to write, "What is nothingness? What is thingliness? What is blackness? What's the relationship between blackness, thingliness, nothingness, and the de-stroke regenerative operations of what Deleuze might call a life in common?" So Moten in the same paper, later kind of talks about Fanon's disavowal of the new speech, kind of the pidgin French that he was kind of encountering. He kind of talks through the problems, I guess, he has with Fanon and the kind of analysing of the use of pidgin in France without kind of investigating how it came to appear in the first place and its logic. He says, it is simply assumed to be both subsequent and subordinate to the standard in its givenness. Is it possible for the new returnee to actually think about pidgin? So let's look to this image of Esquava Anastasia for a moment. With no official history, she is claimed to have been captured by European slavers and brought to Brazil. She was forced to wear this iron collar and a face mask that prevented her from speaking. And so while the historical context of this image is important, I'm actually more interested in it as an image that speaks, or in this case, doesn't speak to the present. It seems like, you know, there's something powerful in the words of this figure. So powerful, in fact, that they must be suppressed at all costs. And yeah, I mean, this image is inspiring kind of a kind of thread of new work for me. And it leaves me wondering if it's in our language, specifically in new forms of, and therefore kind of radical language, that the ultimate refusal might take place. And yeah, I just want to kind of end by saying that, you know, making space for language we don't understand is really crucial. Yeah, I'm going to end there. Okay.
Thank you. Plenty there to discuss later on as well.
Good afternoon or good morning. What time is it? Yeah, good afternoon. I can press it like myself, right? Yeah, okay. And can you lower the light slightly, please? Well, first, it's great to be back in London. It has been quite a while. I would like to start by thanking David Bailey, and to celebrate him for the 20th anniversary of the historical and very important landmark exhibition Mirage, and as well as the conference. And also to thank Astrid and the staff at ICA for facilitating me being here. I was trying to reflect back on when was the last time I was in London, and it wasn't Mirage, but it has been over a decade. And so it's been kicking up a lot of feelings for me, because so many of the people that who have been fundamental to who I am in terms of my work and my process are here in London. I mean, clearly I've been in contact with many of them in the different continents over the last several years, but it's really good to be back here at a certain core source. You know, for me, I first came here in 90, I believe it was in 89, when I was invited by Autograph to do an exhibition, be part of the first exhibition, inaugural exhibition for Autograph, Autoportraits, that, and was like right on the heels of the passing of what to me. So it's really great to be back here. So David's prompt today, which I failed at addressing, but I'm going to be addressing tangentially, and I hope that we can bring up some of the issues that he did prompt me during the conversation. But it's really inspiring to be here, and it's really amazing to have heard from Allison, Morgan, and Yvonne, and Evan, excuse me, whose work is really, I'm not familiar with, and it's really good to become familiar with, and a lot to take with me. So I'm gonna start, okay. So at the risk of not sharing what the work I've been working for the last 20 years since I have been in Mirage, I think you can check it on the website, and there are catalogs, et cetera. But what I wanted to share with you is a recently rediscovered archive, which in a way tangentially addresses some of the issues that we're discussing here today, and offers another reading, if you will, of a lot of the people who have been foundational in this thought. So it's called Archiving Absence. So Archiving Absence is a project that will explore a formative period of profound transformation at the end of the 20th century, spanning three distinct culture spaces, each of which I found myself concurrently implanted in at the time, the Black community, whether that's here in New York, the contemporary art world, and the gay community. Production of this new body of work will entail further excavation under critical interrogation and expand upon just a photographic archive. I should say what we're looking at right here is a recently rediscovered archive of over 3,500 ectochrome slides. I first came re-engaged this archive in 2012 when I, after spending 7 years between Accra and New York, I'm teaching for NYU and maintaining a studio both in New York and Accra. Upon my return, my good friend Isaac Julian had asked me for some slides to use in his upcoming, to illustrate his upcoming MoMA survey show, autobiography. And so I had put this archive away in my mother's cellar in 2000 before I left for Rome to pursue a pre-to-Rome in 2000. And so I had not seen the archive for over, let's say 12, 13 years. And so it was uncanny re-encountering this archive of 35 millimeter slides of friends, family, highly diaristic, Paul Gilroy, Greg Tate, the late Manning Marble. And so I'm in the process now of actually working through this archive. Not only does it include 35 millimeter slides, but it also includes diaries, over 200 hours of unedited video that was done during a particular period. Consisting of over, as I mentioned, 3,500 slides, and they were installed in my mother's house in the Bronx. These images, in a way, document my intimate circle of friends and colleagues from New York, London, Berlin, San Francisco, LA, and elsewhere. And after much deliberation, I recently undertook to revisit this material in response to the inquiry, and have shown it several places. They've shown it at Camera Weems Live at the Guggenheim a year ago, and then also prior to that, it was at Yale University. And in both cases, whether it was at the Guggenheim, where a lot of people had lived during a particular period that had elicited grief, or at Yale, MFA students who had not been born with archive was done, one text, very different responses, but equally powerful. So the images were mostly done prior to me even having my first New York show in New York. Included among the archive images are candid snapshots at public events and private, often intimate moments, such as the late Marlon Riggs medicating himself with AZT while on a break during the shooting of his last film. Photographer Nan Golding applying eyeliner in Berlin. Writer Bell Hooks relaxing home in New York. Photographer Kathy Opie in an embrace among women friends in LA.
also included are self-portraits, images of my family, close friends, lovers, still lives, images of interior and exterior spaces, such as nightclubs that no longer exist, and landscape studies. This is Venice, 92. Berlin, 92, Nan Golden, with a pull-out of bridge photograph from the mirror. Klaus Cortez, managing curate at the MoMA in Berlin, 92. London, 92.
Also rounds. Summing up the people. Checking out the race.
Filtered through the prism of my experience as a fearless to cross boundaries of what swiftly through remaining separate, segregated, mutual communities. I mean, it's often because I mean, getting in terms of thinking about the radical different communities, and often what was radically different by that particular period was a cross-fertilization, which in, ironically has become much more segregated today. Dred Scott. Ikeu Day.
Come in, all you jesters. Enter all you fools. Sit down, no, no. Older fools. Trick to light, fantastic. Dance the swivel hips. Coming at the conclusion.
Bell Hooks, 92.
Walking, walking in the rain.
Glenn Legon, Bell Hooks. Thelma Golden, Gary Simmons. Mother. Marlon Riggs. Marlon Riggs, Gene Riggs, and Grandma Riggs, 2 months before he passed away on his way to receive the award as the youngest tenured professor at Berkeley. The Truce Between the Crips and the Bloods. Blackmail opening, 94. Serrano. carry my wings. Russell Simmons. Bell Hooks, Peter Norton. You know Fred Wilson, of course. Eugenie Tsai curated the Smithsonian Exhibition. Lorna Simpson. Brother Thomas, San Diego, Caracas, Coco Fusco, and Samuel Delaney. At the Black Nations Queer Nation Conference 95, Isaac and Barbara Smith, LA, Griffith Park, Los Angeles. The Hamptons, Kathy Opie, LA, Mina Nanji, Vaginal Cream Davis, with Vinay Cox. Bring your music down, please, a little bit.
Yeah, I was hoping to talk more, but the music was a little loud. Can you bring it down a little bit more, please? Yes, I was trying to say before that, like filtered through my own prism, that what's interesting about me about this archive now is that it captures a certain fertile, rich cross-fertilization that was taking place, let's say, during the period that the archive addresses, whether that's the late 80s to, let's say, 2000, that in a lot of ways feels absent today. And in a way, I can relate to what Morgan was addressing. Recently, on the occasion, for the occasion of the 20th anniversary of the black male show, Thelma Golden's legendary exhibition at the Whitney, I was approached by I guess this would be in the record, by the director of education at that institution, and she came by to look at some of these images to think about presenting them. And she was not aware of the Black Cultural Conference. And I think I just want to leave, the Black Public Culture Conference was a conference that predated Mirage, predated like Black Male Show, where you had, it was a cross-Atlantic conference. It was really the first of its kind. Several images that were in there, for example, Angela Davis, Masha Diawara, Stuart Hall, Coco Fusco, et cetera. It was the first time that there was sort of a collaboration between the Uptown Museum, the Studio Museum in Harlem, and let's say the DS Center for the Arts, where it was about black public culture, theorizing culture. And in a way, what did it mean for a curative education at a leading, you know, global institution not to be aware of, let's say, the Black Public Culture Conference. So I think that's, so when they talk about like Mirage, I think that is present in that day when we create the show, because I think we are so dealing with the idea of the complicatedness in terms of, let's say, cultural amnesia, you know, selective cultural amnesia. And I mean, I'm an artist, you know, I've shown internationally, et cetera. I may also, you know, I'm a, you know, trustee of the American Academy in Rome, but being in the academy at a place like NYU, or at NYU, not a place, at NYU, you get to see how these things, which you think that maybe are dated, are so absolutely necessary in terms of even talking to June yesterday in terms of about her archive at the BFI, I believe, right? How important it is to really think about how do you re-engage, because I think it's one thing for several of us, whether that's Carol Walker, Glenn, et cetera, to have these international exhibitions. But as I said recently at the High Museum, where I won the Driscoll Award, they could go on and clap up and down about an acquisition of, let's say, Candy Wiley, who is a close friend of mine. I photographed him, but to not know Barclay Hendricks and not to have a work of Barclay Hendricks in the collection, then we're at a major crisis in terms of, let's say, well, we can celebrate certain figureheads right now, but in terms of dealing with the art historical legacy, that is at the point we are culturally right now, in terms of academically, and I think Morgan was definitely addressing that. And clearly, Allison was, familiar with this extraordinary work you're doing in Barbados. So I think this is an important time, particularly for this young audience here. How do you make these institutions, because I was giving this talk at La Pietra recently for the Resignification Show and Conference that Deb Willis organized in collaboration with Skip and a number of other people at La Pietra and Awamampa, and I raised a question, well, how do we go back to these respective institutions and to ask them? Because it's one thing for us to go and to celebrate with a Mirage here, but if I go into my class and out of a class of 15 students at NYU on photography performance, and I have no, and this was the first year I actually looked online, you could actually see the faces of the people, you know, so I was sort of like, in a way that I could say I was pre-warned or haunted by what I was about to encounter, and what did I have to do to somehow to almost open up the heart. And speaking of the idea of compassion, I do believe it's important to extend that language, but at the same time to recognize and to make them accountable, the students, for the lack of diversity, et cetera. So both in terms of bodies, but also in terms of the type of information they're receiving. Steve McQueen last year, it was on the film that won the Oscar, and on the eve of the Oscar, how many of my, let's say, 15 students had seen that film? So that's the crisis. Very few. I think it was one or two.
But so it was showing in the theater down the block, but it was absolutely necessary in the pedagogical sense that that film was brought in the context of the classroom. Despite being able to see it at the theater, I went and purchased the film so it could actually see in the context of an institution, NYU. So, well, I look forward to the discussion afterwards. It's really great to be here. Thank you.
So rich. I mean, we could just have the whole day. The afternoon speakers, I think you should just go home, yeah. Because now we can just focus on like the aftermath of this morning. Allison, thank you for sharing and reminding me of the work that's been done in Barbados and also how that's connected to the legacy. I thought it was very important to have that diasporic element. Morgan, again, thank you for also reminding us of, and I think this is very Fanonian, the idea of, you know, let's think about the institutions, the frame of institutions, the processes of institutions, and also the kind of what gets left out and what gets unsaid within that. Love the idea, I'm going to try and see if I can say it, I just think that's very Fanonian in terms of that kind of breakdown. But I mean, yes. I mean,
credit to Lucy Lippard there.
So let's talk a little bit more about that later today. We did actually try to approach Fred, didn't we? Fred couldn't make it, so it was really interesting to hear your remarks about that. But also, I love the idea of the avatar of blackness in your description, but also how you've kind of were oscillating between Fred, Fanon, mediating your own thoughts, and how, what I quite liked about it was how raw and fresh it was, and Lyle, what can we say? I mean, Lyle Ashton Harris and Grace Jones, does it not get any better than that? One of the things it kind of reminded me of is that how I have pictures of my installations, but I don't think I've got any pictures of my openings. Absolutely. Of my openings, of those shows, and how much important about audiences and some who are famous, some who aren't famous, and how those are gatherings, and how that amnesia about forgetting about those gatherings. But also, thank you for kind of letting us kind of look at that amazing personal archive in relation to that. So before I open this up to questions, I mean, one of the things I was thinking about as an opening, and somebody can come in to kind of answer this, is that in a lot of the presentations that you have all given, the question of blackness and the question, and again, Morgan, you mentioned this, in terms of monoculturalism, is it a case now that, okay, 95, we were talking about the question of blackness as an evolving project that at some point would have these strategic markers. 95 was particularly one, and it's interesting, Lyle, that you mentioned about black popular culture, and Allison, you mentioned about Barbados. Is it now the case that we dismantle the question of blackness and think more about what Morgan or what Evan is talking about, the question about the idea that it's no longer important to recognize that. It's no longer, the project isn't about dismantling that. The project isn't about investigating that. The project isn't about exploring that. The project is about kind of like, not even parking it, but thinking about another trajectory, which isn't about that. Or do we still have to go back to that kind of notion of the universal, the blackness, the monoculturalism? But can we now kind of, not put it to one side, but kind of think about another trajectory around that? Who wants to go first in terms of that? Or does that make sense?
I'll give it a shot if you like.
Yes.
I'd say it's not an either or at all. Like, I think we just have to keep doing... Well, I feel like they're just different projects, and as time passes, maybe the responsibility of somebody like me is to try and address all of those areas at the same time. So in, say, in my curatorial critical practice is to be aware of those different fronts and to try and fight on them each time. So maybe an article might have to begin with defining blackness or engaging with that idea, and then possibly dismantling it and then seeing what a possible future might be. But also I think this notion, I mean, it's what's like what Lyle was saying is so important. It's history, you know?
Yes. Yes.
Because it's just, I grew up in London, I'm from London, and one of the experiences that I've had in my life is just that my history is just erased constantly. Every time I walk away from it, it's gone. You know, where I grew up in Clapham, and that era, it just doesn't exist as it used to anymore. And so while I totally understand that there's an impulse to say, oh, we should do away with the archive, it's passé, it's outmoded, I'm afraid my history hasn't been addressed, and so it needs to be addressed. And so that's why I'm so like, I was really emotionally moved when I was watching that archive, and it also made me think, it's my responsibility today to be aware that that's happening now, and I should be out there documenting it.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
And so, yeah, so thank you, and I think, yeah, it's not an either or. Yeah.
Definitely, and just to... No. Yeah. I mean, the archive is so important to me, and I think, you know, I would never want to devalue the work that's already done. For me, the starting point is always an archival one, and even just the other day, I was speaking with Ajamu, you know, about, because I've done some work with his Ruckus archive, which is an archive of kind of Black LGBT. Lives, art, like everything, and it's based at London Metropolitan Archives. And, you know, we were kind of talking about how easily people can forget, and it kind of made me, or, you know, something I'm realizing is that the evidence, whilst very important, is itself not enough. Because actually it's about continually revisiting it, bringing it up. And also I know that for me as an artist, I have a responsibility to keep working with these archives and keep making sure that I'm acknowledging, you know, how I've come to be here, how it's possible for me to be here by engaging with the work, you know, of artists who did kind of work before me and are still working and continue to make those part of the conversations that I'm having. Yeah, so it's crucial to me.
Yeah, I think for me also, one of the things that kept recurring was this idea of the importance of the archive. And seeing the work that you were showing, it was sort of a two-part thing, because it was taking you back to that time and seeing it and realizing the importance of documenting it, but also you're internalizing it in terms of the contemporary. Who are these people? Where are they now? How has that history informed what has happened since that point? And I was also thinking about something you said at the beginning about institutional ambivalence, because it's the institution that preserves the archive. So it's not just a matter of having it. It's a matter of making sure that it has that permanence, but also that it has that accessibility. But the ambivalence then is with the inability of the institution to continually reinvent itself and to make itself increasingly relevant and useful in the contemporary moment.
Now, I was recently at a forum, you know, the MoMA does these amazing photography forums, and they recently put out the first of a 3-volume book on the history of the MoMA collection photography, and the first one they published was From the 60s to the Present, and I'm in there. And there were several artists, you know, including Paul Graham, you know, the English photographer. It was a lot of people in the audience. And there was one photographer whose work, should I remain nameless or not? Let me think about that. But I'm going to be delivering one of the keynotes talks at SPE, and I was going to save it for there. But he, who am I thinking of? He was a famous photographer, teachers at Yale. And he asked the question at this, you know, packed house collectors, trustees of the MoMA, you know, photographers, et cetera, what is them? And there were seven writers, there were four curators, Quaintance, who's the director of photography, Roxana, the senior photo curator, Eva, who just did the Wally Reed exhibition, she was formerly of MoMA, she's at the ICA, Lucy Galan, you know, co-curated the Sidney Sherman show, as well as Chris Williams, and David Campany, your own very David Campany, and one other professor from Columbia. And so this very well-known photographer, this famous photographer who's crossed over to both the, you know, critical success in terms of the commercial, the fine art world, but also the commercial, he asked from second row center, why does the MoMA feel pressure to open up, to diversify. And that was very telling for me, you know, and maybe it has to do with interpretation, but what I gathered from, because in a certain sense, this is a radically, if you look at my brother's film, let's say, Through the Lens Darkly, where in the book you have Deborah Wallace talking about that, when she began doing her work on black photography, going back to the 70s, she was looking at the seminal books on photography, and there were black people in the book, but none of them were photographers, all of them were subjects or objects of the camera itself. And how this book is radically different in terms of like the level of multiple subjectivities, you know, African diaspora, Asian, you know, Atlantic, across Atlantic. But he was asking a question. Why does the institution feel the need to diversify? So I found that was very, I don't have the answer, but I think it is telling, it's something I, as an academic, that I need to find the context. I was saving this for SPE to really take it on, because I think that's a question where we are. And if it was just an artist, that would not matter. But when I encounter students, 20, 30, who go to Yale, I mean, I've taught at Yale, so nothing against Yale. I love Yale's actually being exemplary in terms of its diversity, in terms of the student population. But he was asking the question I'm interested in when I encounter artists who study with him. That's how the ideology gets perpetrated. So I'm interested in that. So the question, do we have to really rethink about, you know, you ask a question around blackness. I think, you know, what I draw from Fanon is a polyvocal. I think one has to operate on multiple fronts, et cetera. You know, most recently I was joined the board of the American Academy in Rome, and a year ago the Academy was thinking about, obviously we're getting ready for Oakley's amazing show, you know, at the Venice Biennale, and I was wondering how can the Academy itself, considering its tradition, its history, deal with issues of race at the Academy, but also in Italy in general. So it took a year to create the show that opened, you know, during last spring, but really looking at the history of race. In fact, a fellow trustee who is Frank Snowden. Frank Snowden is the son of the legendary Frank Snowden, who was seminal black classicist at Howard for 50 years. So whether you were David Driscoll, you know, anyone have studied with him. But his son is on the board, and his father was the first African-American appointed to ambassador role anywhere in 53. In Italy. But 2 years before, he was in Rome at the Academy to work on his dissertation on but blacks in antiquity, and he was asked by the then president of the American Academy to leave because there were Southerners at the Academy who did not feel comfortable residing with an African-American, a black person at the Academy. The irony was that 2 years later, he was representing the U.S. as a cultural attaché. So I think these issues, I think it's, I'm totally for crossing multiple borders, but at the same time, I think it's also important to be, you know, rigorous and to be mindful, you know, because it is shocking when you encounter, you know, in the everyday, whether in the Academy or the day-to-day, I mean, thinking about even Thelma's, you know, brilliant concept of post-black, but then how radically did that get challenged in the level of violence against black bodies globally, you know, particularly in New York and terms of Black Lives Matter? How does that stand up in relationship to that? So I think these are where we are in terms of these types of questions. So for me.
So the question leading from that then is, and I understand it's, we can do both, but we can't do everything. So is the focus now in this moment on individual agency, the idea now that we, through web, we can broadcast, we can internet, we can build infrastructural, visual, representational, and network and develop those through our own individual agencies. And your archive isn't an archive that is represented by MoMA or by, it's your personal
archive. Well, right now, that
archive
is being, you know, sought after by a few institutions. Clearly, someone's going to write about, several institutions.
Yeah.
Clearly, someone's going to write about that, but it's up to me, because I think it gets back to Evan is saying that, because for me,
I'm here for answers. Right? I'm here to throw it out because I don't want it to be a nostalgic thing. How do I engage? And that's really my work over the next couple of years. How do I make this active? What are the narratives? In fact, I was talking to an artist in L.A. Because what did it mean that Coco Fusco and Sammy Delaney in the same? I mean, we would not imagine that certain individuals in the same space. And I'm having to really throw it back myself. What does that mean to me today? And so I'm in the process of talking to a couple of publishers about writing a personal narrative in relationship to that. But I think it's individual, but I think it's collective. I think as Dan Prosser's exemplary, because it's not just about race or blackness, it's about class and it's about the institutional structures. What does it mean to somehow go beyond, let's say, the oversaturation of, let's say, the biennial model and to find other ways of, let's say, exploring high-low. I was not familiar with that. For me, that's exemplary. Having lived in Ghana and created an art center there and see, so I'm very familiar what it means to negotiate both high-low. Yeah. I was very much interested in what that means. So I think it's also really looking at taking the lead from like youth culture, I think it's something, for me, it's exciting.
Okay, yeah. But that still throws in the question for me that, okay, I'm coming from a generation which is about collective agency and the collective network and collective, but I get a sense now that the vanguard now is individual agency. And one of the things I was interested to talk about yesterday, which I wanted to raise today, is I can't remember when it was, but it was the point when that black guy couldn't get on a train in Paris because the Chelsea supporters were doing racist chants, which I thought was a very much a Fanonian moment, contemporary. But what I found interesting about that moment was that it was being reported back by somebody who had the individual agency to record it, document it, and then somehow do a kind of editorial on it through whatever social media which was going on, which was quite radically different to how a kind of a BBC collective news agency would approach that, which is why I'm thinking, is it now about individual agency around that?
But is that different to how things always have been? Because I suppose it takes one person to break a story and then everyone to jump on it. So you're just sort of saying that one person has shifted from a professional to a citizen in that instance. So I don't know. I still think it's about, because he could have blogged it and nobody could have read it, or people couldn't have responded.
Yeah.
So even though it's tempting to say, like Time Magazine, you are the person of the year, I still think it's still that push and pull between individual action and then collective agency. Again, maybe I'm hedging my bets, but I just feel like it's and that's the thing about heterogeneity. It still rears its head in these dynamics. We can't just say, well, it's this focus or it's this focus. I think it's always a mix and match of different approaches.
I love the idea that you have your own web and you can broadcast. That's like,
yeah, but you know
that
what?
Cuts through so much different.
Yeah, okay.
Do you see what I mean? Right. You're saying, oh, and I can now broadcast.
Yeah, it might cut through, yeah. But the thing is, you have to still be that guy who's there pushing this stuff.
Yeah.
And nobody comes to see it and nobody comes to check it out. You're grafting, you're trying to get funding, you go around the world, you do a project where you, I mean, like, I thought we did the, sorry to get on my horse, but I just feel so, sometimes I get so upset about it. You know, we went all over the world, we did this project, and we still struggle to get people to come and look at it and watch it,
Yeah.
And you go to a fair like Frieze. I went to art fair, Frieze Art Fair a couple of weeks ago, I did a talk for free. But people had to pay to get in, right? Okay, fair enough. But someone came up to me at the end and said, oh, this is so good. I just came here for this talk. And I just couldn't believe it. I said, I do this stuff for free. I do this stuff all the time. How could you not know that I do this stuff all the time? So I guess the idea of the individual, I can't, as an individual, penetrate into the popular consciousness. I still need the collective agency to get out there.
Okay,
the same way Frieze can put a talk on with me in it, and people just know that's happening and think, oh, I like that guy, I want to go to that. And not know that I do this for free every last Sunday of the month. You can come, you can go online and download a film that we shot, like 45-minute film that tells you all about. So, I don't know, yeah.
Yeah, and to kind of continue on with that, I work as part of two different collectives, and actually I think that, you know, the network which you know, Junior, maybe Larry and others are part of, and then collective creativity, and that, you know, they're very different projects, but I would say that both are crucial to me being able to exist here as an artist. Like, I wouldn't be able to do this if I didn't have those spaces to create discourse ourselves, you know, and not rely or wait on some, you know, curator, whatever, to kind of acknowledge our existence. You know, I don't, for me, I think the two have to coexist, you know, definitely.
Yeah. Alison, and then I'm going to open it up for questions to the audience.
Well, I was just going to congratulate you, because I think one of the nice things about today is that it's not just talking about the accomplishments of what happened 20 years ago, but it's using that platform to allow younger artists and younger curators to come in to talk about their projects and in that sense kind of see that synergy and continuity.
Can I just add very quickly?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, just to follow up on Allison's point, I do feel, I think you mentioned their plan to do another exhibition, Mirage, because I think it is important to somehow go from a Mirage to the Academy Award with Steve McQueen, for example, to see a project, whether that's a curatorial project in addition to a book that actually deals, because we're mentioning certain names like Glenn, yes, like Glenn Ligon or Glenn Ligon, but to think about, I think it's important for the next generation to somehow see that the importance, let's say, for archive, for history, for community, but also of culture preservation, I mean, that Al is so deeply embedded in. I think Mirage too, because I mean, you talk about, let's say, someone asked about the press yesterday, and I think even that, to do a rereading of that, similar to how Thelma Golda did a reading of her Michael Kimmelman's press. She doesn't read a press, but she did on the occasion for Carrie Mae Weems Live, where she gave an amazing talk, looking at that the culture had to catch up. So I think it's important for you to really think about an exhibition on multiple platforms that actually, and that is an archive in of itself, how do these people don't just come out of nowhere? I mean, similar to what I was saying at the High Museum, who I love, the great, you know, David Driscoll's extraordinary, even thinking like someone, David Driscoll, legendary, you know, art historian that everyone from whoever has studied with him, but re-looking at that work from the standpoint of today, I think that's important to do that, you know.
Okay, so we've got a few minutes before we break for lunch, but we'd love to kind of open this up to the audience. Do you want to say where you... Sorry, just... It's on the front, sorry.
Do you want me to introduce myself?
Yes, please.
Okay. Hi, my name is Alice Reckab, and I'm an Irish artist of Sierra Leonean descent, and my question is about code switching, which is something that I encounter when I go to make my films in Sierra Leone. In working with the performers that I work with, but then also my primary platform for exhibition is in Ireland and in England. So I'm essentially bringing the work that I make back to Ireland and England to show it. The reason for this is because there's no equivalent platform in Freetown to show the work that we make. So there's a long list of reasons, I'm sure, but corruption, lack of infrastructure like electricity, political unrest in the past. We have a museum in Freetown for some kind of individual historical artworks, but no contemporary art space. And that creates this kind of break, you know, between the art that I could produce there and how it gets exhibited or how it gets shown. The people I work with, Stars Combine, distribute it through their network, which is through like a VCDs, like video CDs, and they sell them individually like that. When I bring them to Europe, it's shown usually in a space that is not necessarily got the best platform, but will be it's always, there's this kind of transition or way that it has to be suddenly reframed as a contemporary artwork from where it's made, which is not necessarily what we're thinking when we're making it. So there's this kind of transition between somewhere where there's no equivalent institution to make it in reference to that in its current space, and then it kind of has to move into this, like, yeah, I find it really, really kind of a difficult thing to think and to kind of manage in terms of the conversations I have with my collaborators and the conversations I have with curators when I come to try and bring the work to another audience. And also these very practical kind of things that happen where I can't get my collaborators' visas to come to Ireland to perform the work or to speak for the work with me, so I become the only kind of representative for the work that we create together.
Did you find anything in Allison and Morgan's presentation that maybe gave you possible ways in which to engage that, whether Sierra Leone or here or globally? Because I think there were two very different but radically important ways of thinking about engaging, where, because I think the idea that it doesn't exist, I think that's a, that could be a project. I mean, I had a similar thing in Ghana. You know, there's ways of making intervention. In fact, a very close friend of mine, Sanamo Kujata, who's at the Academy now, she, for example, there is a national regime in Ghana. It's quite conservative, but there has emerged through a collective sense of artists, you know, working with private collections, opening, making curatorial projects with those. And for example, in Ghana, for example, she with Godfrey Doncor, your very own Godfrey Doncor, who is Ghanaian artist, we actually invited 20 local newspapers, leading newspapers, and we dashed them, or I guess tipping, whatever you want to call it. They came and we actually staged an exhibition and actually did a journalism workshop right there. That was in 2007. Since then, any art exhibition in Ghana has been covered in the national, if not several national newspapers, just by that simple intervention. So I think it is possible. I think there's always a way around. And for me, having done a lot of work in Ghana, there's no way that I could show work that I made in Ghana in the U.S. and not show it there. In fact, I remember when I had a show in New York titled Ghana, and I did not want to send the review. It was reviewed by Hilton, Holland Cotter. And Holland Collar, and in it he mentions near the end that I'm bringing a new sense of queer sensibility to the continent, etc. And I was afraid that, oh my God, if they were to see that. When I got back to Ghana, my three graduate interns congratulated me in the article. In my own mind, I thought I could somehow control. They're way ahead in terms of technology and being able to source material. So I think there's a way we have to be more resourceful, more creative, how do we work in any number of locations, no matter what. And I think there are a lot of healthy models for that today.
What were you going to?
I was just going to say that in terms of when I try to go and initiate these things, trying to justify why this might be relevant to the Sierra Leonean curator of the National Museum, I find it as difficult. So it's like trying to create, in a sense, and as an artist, this is a really interesting process where I'm trying to say why contemporary art might be important, and why it might be useful, why it might be something that could gain an interest and should. And often the question is, well, what will that do for us? Like, how will that make the museum more popular? How will that get more people in here when it's already extremely inaccessible when you have like people who don't earn enough money to gain entry to the museum, you know, in 1 week. And it's just, just kind of trying to bridge these sort of gaps, and where there are controls like that in place, it's not, certainly as an individual artist trying to kind of work kind of on my own in many ways in Sierra Leone and on my own with that project in Ireland and England, it's not something I feel that is very easy to do. And trying to renegotiate and redefine sort of what the practice is to different people, hoping that it'll be understood within its context when those contexts are actually multiple.
Yeah, I can see where you're coming from, and I think that's like the curator's malady in a way, because even now working in, say, London, you have to talk to so many different people, and every person you talk to is a different incarnation of the project, from the artist to the stakeholder to the blah blah blah, blah to the person you want to pay for the show, but...
And I think there's a really inherent politics of power in that, and I think that needs to, that's kind of why I wanted to open it up, because I think that there's something really, I feel like that's a mirror of the kind of politics that happens in trying to make a work between two cultures, or within a culture that I have an experience of, but not an Indigenous experience of. You know, my kind of relationship with Sierra Leone is through my grandmother and through my father, who are from Sierra Leone, but I only visited there in the last couple of years, and this, as a personal journey, that's an effort that I kind of wanted to make. And then the work that I make there is all about this sort of negotiating my difference or my apparent difference in that context, and then trying to find, and then bringing that work back. It's again this sort of like on a kind of a more meta level, negotiating that difference back again to whoever will listen, and sort of this desire to sort of integrate the work somehow that it'll become more desirable, and this trying to make myself desirable, make the work desirable, justify the work in the context that it needs to be justified in to get the platform that I wanted to have, so like the work can continue to gain the funding to go back to, you know, pay everyone fairly.
Whoa, and so man, on and like, so on. Yeah, there's like a lot to unpack there and a lot to deal with. It's kind of, I'm not really sure how to respond. I feel like that's something I'd have to sit down and tap, you know, like a good hour long. And I don't mean to be dismissive. I don't mean to be at all. But I'm like, that's a full-on discussion, and like how, and some concrete outcome to that discussion as well, not just a.
I guess I brought it to the floor because I thought it felt like something that each of you must encounter in your own individual way.
Well, can I can tell you a very quick incident that happened to me in the late 90s when I was in Haiti. And I was going to see the work of two artists, André Eugène and Salur. And at that point, they'd never been outside of Haiti. The work had never been outside of Haiti. And Leah Gordon has since started working a lot with them through the Ghetto Biennial and included their work in the show that was up in Nottingham in 2012. But in the late 90s, it was a very different kind of space for them. And we went down into the heart of Port-au-Prince in conditions that I had never seen before. And they start pulling out this work, you know, statues that are about this high, wooden sculptures, if you didn't see the show in Nottingham, wooden figurative sculptures with all sorts of sort of found materials that are then kind of hammered onto these sculptures. And on the side of the road, there was this row of cars, and they would put one of the sculptures up on the bonnet, and then up on the hood, and then down at the back. And then they start bringing out sculptures that are 6 feet high and 8 feet high and 10 feet high. And I don't know why they're making these works, because there's nowhere to show them, let alone store them. I mean, what is the compulsion to make this work? And now we're stopping traffic and people are gathering around us. And the next thing I know, like, we are just surrounded by 10, 50, 100 people. It was the best opening I have ever been to. And it just kind of completely changed my concept of what an exhibition is. It had a whole different vitality. It was for a whole different reason with a whole different audience. So important.
Another question? Can we bring the slide down slightly over here, please?
It's like Jerry Lane, isn't it?
Yeah.
Hi there. I've got a quick question for Evan and
Who are you?
Riyadh. A slightly more long-winded one to follow. So the question for Evan is, I was really tantalised by the last, by the closing remark in your presentation. You talked about making a space for language we don't understand being something really crucial. And my question to you was, who's the we? Who is the we that don't understand, who don't understand the language?
Okay, let's take that one.
Yeah.
Where we run with that one.
Okay. Yeah. No. Well, thank you for your question. I guess I included myself in that by calling it we, because, but I'm referring to kind of institutions in that sense, like the people that I work with, and I say we because I work with them, so I'm complicit in that system. And I guess that was touching on kind of what I started with at the beginning, some of the past kind of interactions that I've had, which, you know, sometimes it does become an issue of language, of not understanding what it is or why it is that somebody, one, makes the work, and what the work, you know, what might be that impetus, you know, and actually, you know, somebody, you know, we don't necessarily have to prescribe to certain types of models or, and I think also I'm thinking about that in relation to kind of some interactions I've had around kind of gender and sexuality and how, you know, my work is being framed in certain ways, I think, to make the work more easily understood, when actually I don't necessarily want to engage with my work through that kind of language. So it was also kind of, yeah, touching on some of that stuff. Yeah, I'm just going to say that. I hope that's all right. Let somebody else speak.
And I think you had a follow-up
question.
Okay.
Thank you for that. I'll try and make it brief. Okay. Just in relation to institutions, And
is this to everybody, or is it just...
Yeah, I think it's a general one to the panel in relation to the notion of the institution, because it's a bit of a shifting...
Oh, sorry, say that again?
The notion of the institution, because it's quite a shifting idea. I was really struck watching Lyle, your film, and that period. In the early 90s, I was studying post-colonial theory. And so people like bell hooks and Paul Gilroy were regarded as intellectual heroes. And as their books were coming out, we were imbibing them as almost tablets of wisdom. I was very conscious doing my PhD of how one is positioned in relation to authority. So I'd be writing in my essays, I'd be talking about the black canon, the black literary canon, the black theoretical canon. My supervisor, who was herself within her circle quite a well-regarded intellectual, would say there is no canon. But for me, from the generation that I was coming from, and also from my social class, coming from outside of academia, from outside of the middle class, in some sense, how one's positioned in relation to authority or what can appear from your social position as a canon, as an already formed community with its own authenticating and authorising means for giving itself legitimacy and value, can make a lot of difference. So the idea of institution is not necessarily an absolute. It's often where you're placed in relation to it, and that there are some authenticating ways in which those kind of social groupings, those communities of intellectuals and artists, because of their positioning in relation to other people, can authenticate some of these things and do give them some authority. And I suppose my point is that I'd like you to reflect on is that there are institutions within institutions, just going back to, say, someone like Pierre Bourdieu and his idea of restricted fields of cultural production, which is the place where artists make their work, and also the place within which intellectuals produce their outputs and renew themselves. There are cultures and subcultures within those for authenticating and creating a sense of value from things, and also creating outsiders within those, outside of those.
Who wants to go for that one?
I don't know if I can address that. I do appreciate the question. But I guess when it comes up for me, I can't but help think about, again, to go back to David and commend him, you know, for the visionary concept of, let's say, Mirage, and thinking about what it meant for him to think of Frantz Fanon, who for me is exemplary of transgression, whether institution of the family, of the colony. I mean, continual transgressions to his death at an early age. And I'm struck by that David would actually see to give a certain amount of elasticity, to somehow give an intellectual framework, an elastic framework where artists and theorists could actually begin to poke, begin to engage. Thinking of the remastering of Isaac's film last night, it was brilliant just to see a lot of the same issues we're addressing here, how he, without somehow saying right or wrong, it was much more about the idea of elasticity, prodding at the same time, as opposed to somehow saying, well, Fanon is, let's say, bad because of X, Y, and Z, the gender issues or homophobia, whatever. For me, I think it's broader. I mean, I could critique that at the same time. I'm much more interested in the polyvocal, you know, nature of his brilliance, you know, in the matter I am of, let's say, Pasolini, for example, or Jean Genet. I mean, in terms of, like, really radical thought, and I think in terms of, I mean, in that sense, I'm interested in biography, in terms of thinking about what led to that, and what, so.
And I think, you know, in terms of our relationship to the institution, sometimes it's a matter of finding the right institution. And as you were speaking, I was thinking about, again, Morgan's model of the trialectic. So, you know, it's finding that right space that's going to validate the canon that works for you.
Yeah. That's constantly evolving.
I kind of want to engage, but I'm a little bit at a loss in a way, because I think this depends on what your definition of an institution is. Like, institutions are, well, they're collections
of...
What you want me to? Oh, well, like. Well, like often when we get into sort of grey areas of abstraction, there is a concrete definition that we all ascribe to, and then to fuel debate and discourse, we can fly off into levels of abstraction where anything can be an institution. But on sort of the real side of things, most of us think of institutions as organisations that have norms of operation and procedures that are housed within a building or a structure that you can engage with in a specific way that they set the bar for. But then you could say, well, there's institutions that relate to gender and sexual. So I don't know. I suppose when I talk about maybe institutional behaviours in terms of the art world, I'm talking about that traditional idea of institutions, I guess. And so I'm not. I was in that. That's where I was a bit confused because I was like, I was wondering what you were looking for in terms of a response in relation to that. Okay. I mean.
I suppose this is the ones that you're talking about, the institutional barriers that artists will come up against in terms of putting on their work. And I think your point is that there's a difficulty in that mediation of your work in those institutions in terms of your personal voice and what you're seeking to express and the way that those institutions are, in the way that they're representing those, not giving you the voice that you want to present. So I do get that sense of institution. What I'm talking about, though, in relation to communities of intellectuals or communities of artists, they do in themselves cohere into communities that have some form of validation. Oh, okay. And they in themselves, as a group, enable funding to enter into their areas. They set themselves up with manifestos. You know, the fact that we're here under this umbrella of something that happened 20 years ago, it becomes in some sense not an institution, but it becomes something that could become a vehicle for funding, it becomes a vehicle for thought, it has an authority.
And are you lamenting the disappearance of that? Because a lot of the figures that you talked about were sort of early 90s. Was that what the core of what were you sort of saying, this can happen, and we saw a lot of the giants of that particular movement at one particular time represented in Lyle's film, but perhaps that's sort of disappeared today. Was that? Are you not?
No,
right. What? I'm just trying to think.
I'm giving you an example from my own history of seeing an institution which people around me, because of where they were positioned, didn't see as an institution. So I was positioned as a student undertaking courses on post-colonial literature, Black cultural studies, and for me this all cohered as a canon, and watching the film I could see I wasn't in that social group that met those particular intellectuals, because they're all gods, you know, as far as we were concerned. You know, these people we read in books and imbibed their works, you know, as great wisdom and so on. So I'm saying we're positioned differently in relation to systems that can create authority and value, and to suggest it's just the traditional funding bodies or just the big art establishments. They're institutions within institutions.
I think I know what you mean.
Can I address? I mean,
I was going to address that, but I can wait.
Okay. Well, Lyle, and then can Morgan have the last, and then we can break for lunch, can we do that?
So I just want to, I mean, I appreciate the question. I just want to say from a very personal note, I think that for me is one of the driving forces, if you will, of the archive, because when it was done, for example, speaking of the institution, David wanted me to address some of the work that was in the Blackmail show. Now, I was really out there, and in fact, it was the British, it was David, specifically Isaac, Stuart Hall, Jonah Comfort, Martina, who validated me in a way that, Corcofusco, in a way that I did not feel validated as an American on the shores of America. There was something about a much more polyvocal notions of blackness and gender that was coming out of, Hazel Carby, coming out of the work that was being done here that I had to be re-imported back into the US. So when the Blackmail show, I was there in the show, but a lot of people who dark photographed, shown in the photographs, the purpose of the archive of photographing for me at the time, not the archive of photographing, was to, in a way similar to Agent Piper, to validate my right to be there, all that I was on the stage, I was on display, but not feeling, because those are institutions as well, that I might have been in the show, but I might have been considered persona non grata for the type of work I was doing around Black masculinity. Yeah. Now that has shifted. Now, 10 years ago, I was hired by, let's say, Vibe magazine to photograph, whether that's Al Sharpton. You know, it was interesting. It took 10 years for the culture. In fact, I was considered persona non grata because of my sexual difference, that I would be the one who actually would photograph most recent Ta-Nehisi Coates. So it is interesting, our notion in relation to the institution shifts. Similar with the queer community. I was celebrated, but because of my radical insertion of Black politics in relationship to race and sexuality, that I was outside that circle. So I think in a way, things are, for me, are constantly shifting. So I'm recently engaging with a Lacanian psychoanalysis analyst, and she's saying, well, why do you always want to, because I always want to be, I want to be accepted, I want to somehow be part of the in circle, when in actuality, I have developed by being outside of that space and redefining of what that space actually is. But it's in the archive itself that shows the residual, oh, that it wasn't there because I wanted to photo. I mean, even with bell hooks, but what did it mean to document highly personal? I mean, think about Nan Goldin's work, The Battle of Sexual Dependency. Where in Black cultural discourse internationally do you get that mercurial softness, the personal, and I was interested in document what that experience was for me. Not out of the idea of I want to photograph it, but the need to acknowledge the fact that I was alive, I was present when a lot of people were fading and leaving, so. That for me was the essence of that.
Morgan, and then we'll, if you want to say
it. I think maybe just leave it, maybe let someone else ask this question. Yeah.
Okay, so can we just thank our speakers for our first.